Pretty much everybody in this room knows more about finance than I do. Some of the people I learned basics of finance are in this room today. So, but I'm going to give it a try. Coming from all these young people, right? This is the population graph of India. age crops, right? Most people are earning age or below, right? Or they're going to get into earning age. The other way I like to look at it is, these are the guys who are shopping today, they're going to be saving tomorrow, right? So all the guys on Myntra, Flipkart are potential customers for wealth managers, mutual fund distributors like us. I'm going to overlay these two graphs. And this is really interesting to see. Essentially, all of the money that's being managed today is mature money, right? This is mature money coming from people, the higher income groups. We really haven't started seeing money coming from the guys who are getting into the workforce today and will get into the workforce over the next 10, 15 years, right? And it looks like a tsunami, right? This is that, right? And the industry is not really prepared for this. I think both from the asset management side and from the distribution side, we just don't have the capacity for this. The second trend, I think Accumulation Research talks about it a lot, is investable surpluses are growing, and they're growing towards the bottom of the pyramid as well. So more and more, as incomes are growing, people are aspiring for better things and therefore looking into investing. The unfortunate part is the current model only addresses the tip of the pyramid. Right? It's designed in such a way that the economics of the model are built in such a way that it only addresses the tip of the pyramid. Right? So your standard RM, having to generate 3x the salary as revenue, is something that only works at that part. Right? Mutual funds have a 5,000 rupee minimum for a first-time investment, right? Seems ridiculous. Why would you do? Transaction costs are pretty low. But that's a legacy. Because everything is only being designed for that set of customers. What happens to people who want to invest smaller amounts? For somebody who wants to invest, 500 is maybe a little too utopian, right? But if somebody wants to invest 2,000 rupees or 3,000 rupees or 5,000 rupees even, you can't really give them a diversified portfolio. Because he's going to invest 5,000 rupees in one mutual fund. So these are issues that I think are systemic, some of them, and some of them related to distribution. The second one is that most of our current distribution models are built on facilitating transactions. Getting out there, getting to the customer, taking his check, taking his form, shipping it back. Right? Transaction, especially with online, is becoming commodity. There is no money to be made in transaction. The customer doesn't see value in transaction. What he sees value in is advice. And advice is unviable to provide at the current cost structures. Right? So for example, if you look at a guy with a 10 lakh portfolio, trail available on that is 0.5%. That's 5,000 rupees. It costs today, we did this calculation, it costs an advisor about 22,000 rupees per annum per customer to deliver quality advice. So the result of that, really what happens is, to make up that money, if you want to serve that customer through the current physical model, to make up that money, you will see mis-selling. You will see bad products being sold. Because you've got to make up the difference between 5,000 and 22,000 rupees, and then make a profit without that. The other one is, with online, I think the transaction roles are blurry. Right? Manufacturers will do a lot more advice. So manufacturers, in my particular case, are doing AMCs. They will reach directly to customers, start offering advice. Today, a manufacturer really stops here. Right? He does the asset management, he creates a product, and he gives it to a distributor. Distributor, through some advice, gets it out of the consumer. Right? Advisors will move towards in this direction. Right? So Skillbox, for example, does these three, advice, distribution, and product. Right. And I'll tell you a little bit more about what we do with Skillbox. What these two preceding trends, the challenge to kind of counter this is, the manufacturer's DNA is not, or the current distribution system's DNA is not really advice-centric. Right. You've got to look at things fundamentally differently to be able to do that. For example, you know, rather than focusing on a transaction, you've got to start looking at lifetime value for customer. To start looking at lifetime value for customer, you've got to be nicely capitalized. Because the customer is going to give you that money over a period of time, whereas your costs are upfront. pushing us in that direction.
Right, so there's a very clear mandate that more advice has to be available and more about appropriateness of product to consumers. Right, so that's a more fundamental thing. We still haven't gotten to fiduciary standard as in the West. I think that will come as well, in which case you, our role as distributors will be more of that of a fiduciary rather than that of some regulation products. Why does it say that spring is coming? Right? And this is what's happening. Right? So we've got uniform KYC. If the latest finance ministry proposal does get implemented quickly, what you're going to see is the ability for all of us to onboard customers. If you have a bank account, you should be able to invest. Today, the KYC process is a big, big bottleneck. Right? It's a physical bottleneck. It's also it's just resistance. Right? People don't like to do things. And getting them to do one more form, one more KYC is a nightmare. The payments infrastructure is improving dramatically. So NPCI has done an excellent job facilitating transactions. Payment banks over the next couple of years will probably improve that even further. Banking inclusion will just help us go down the pyramid. But the final one, right, e-commerce. And I listed here because my friends in e-commerce, what they're helping us build is an equity culture. Everybody and their cousin wants to build an app and get rich. Right? It's a long step from FDs to equity, but it's a very small step from being an entrepreneur to equity investor. And I think culturally the mindset is changing in India. So this is what I talked about spring. There's a nation, low penetration of financial assets, emerging from a very high period of high inflation, global crisis, but a young demographic, and seeds of an equity culture. Let's look at what happened to the country. This was US in the 1980s. Right? We had 5% mutual fund penetration. India is approximately there now. Right? It grew 10x over the next 30 years. Predominantly led by baby boomers, like India's young demographic, the tsunami that I showed you. These are the guys who came into the workforce at this time, started investing. The big one was they were assisted by a bunch of advisors. So guys like Merrill, Schwab, Fidelity rolled out nationwide advisory platforms. At that time, they were distribution platforms and actual physical service centers. So much so that even today, 80% of retail AUM in the US is managed by independent financial advisors. And their advice is very critical to move people away from non-financial assets like gold, real estate, or fixed deposit, that's what we have, to actually equity and other financial products. What's happening in the US now over the last 2 or 3 years is you're seeing algorithmic advisors, guys like Wealthfront, Betterment. We believe India, as it has leapfrogged many other technologies earlier, is going to leapfrog this entire physical advisor space. Right? Because physical advisors are just not viable in India. Right? And move directly to online advice, which is the space we play in. That's the box. We hope to add a lot of value to consumers. So how do we do this? We combine the portfolio theory, so we make a very solid database selection of mutual funds for people to invest in, and we combine it with behavioral finance. So financial decisions are scary, not to people in this room, but pretty much everybody, 90% of the population out there, you talk to them about finance, eyes glaze over, right? It's too scary. I don't want to talk about it. I will talk about it tomorrow. That tomorrow never comes. How can you make that product into something that is as tempting as a donut to Homer Simpson? Really, that's the problem. So what we've done in Scriptbox is created a default consumer product, sans all the jargon, no fancy words, no talk of XIRR, actually a little bit because the regulator requires it, but you know, just one best-in-class choice. There are 8,000 mutual funds. We pick the 4 best equity funds and say, here they are, please invest in them. This is what Scriptbox looks like.
I'm hoping all you guys will go home tonight and sign up for it, so at least I get my ticket paid for. But seriously, as simple as this, start investing, click on that button, the four recommended funds are there, put your money there, the money goes from your bank account and you're done. We'll monitor it for you, every year we'll review it, again using the same algorithms, recommend a change if required, and most important after that, something which most consumers don't even understand, but guys in this room will, we make sure that the rebalancing or switching of funds is done with taking all impact costs into account. So taxes, exit load, everything is taken into account with algorithms, making sure that the customer doesn't lose money when he's switching from one mutual fund to the other. Something that happens pretty often in the physical world, where he's switching from one mutual fund to the other every 3 months and losing money in any transaction. So make really, really complex investing tasks easy. So it's a consumer product, it's not a financial product. And then we back it up with consistent performance. So if you look at the track record, some of the backtesting data, this outperformance is available today, right? We all know this. Our performance is available because mutual funds are able to generate alpha net of expenses in India. The challenge is that the consumer doesn't follow a real disciplined investing process. He moves from one fund to the other, he moves from one asset class to the other. And so today, for example, thousands of customers would have moved out of India. But if you can keep them on a disciplined investing process, this return is possible. It's a great return, right? 3% above the benchmark. Where do you get this? So we combine three things, algorithms, some elements of behavioral finance. So for example, you don't see percentage return anywhere on this screen. We show accumulation. You invested so much, it's become so much. The percentage returns, first of all, are rarely understood by consumers. Second is, if they are understood, they usually lead to bad behavior. Market goes up, I've got 40% is the gambler's instinct, let me take the chips and go with. So the guy says. So we don't show percentage returns. It's available as a performance, but we don't put it out front. When we made this change, we saw a dramatic change in consumer behavior. People who were reacting to every move of the market, so we stopped doing it. And then we make it really, really simple. So I keep saying this is a consumer product, so it's got to be built like that. So everything is one click, very clearly available, large buttons, you know, no confusion, not multiple choices, just guiding the people down a particular path of long-term discipline investing. So what does that mean as a business for us? So we today have a less than 4% attrition rate of customers. Because if it is right for the customer will stay with them. And that's our belief. And that's the belief that we build Skillbox on. That's it. Thank you.
What's your traction so far?
So attraction is fairly small. We haven't been that long. Our current AUM is about 85 crores. Most of it's come in the last 12 months. Funding wise, we just raised a Series A with Axel Partners and some angels. So we made my trip team, Deep Karra, Rajesh, and both our investors. Axel was actually a seed investor. They invested 2 years ago as a seed investor and then before.
Do we register as a registered investment advisor?
So we are a registered distributor. So we follow a distribution model. Our compensation comes from the manufacturer, not from the consumer.
So you're not required to be registered. So no paperwork in that sense.
More important, I think, is the compensation remuneration model. I mean, we believe that India is not yet ready for consumers actually having the inclination and, I would say, value perception to be able to directly pay out money. They pay out money indirectly, right? But not directly pay out money.
There is a platform which is being readied, MF Utility, which will allow direct investments across all mutual funds in the direct plans.
Absolutely.
Isn't that a big threat?
So it's not a big threat because we don't see ourselves as a transaction platform. Right? So people who are only looking for, and in fact, that's a validation of our belief that transaction is commodity. So if all you're doing is enabling a transaction, then you could actually go to the MFU and invest in a direct plan and save 0.5%. When a customer invests through me, he's paying that 0.5% extra for the value that he gets. And the value is in terms of fund recommendation, in terms of helping them follow a disciplined investing process, right, holding their hand literally through the days.
And lastly, what is your customer acquisition breakup? Do you get it from Google advertising, offline? What's it?
So, we actually follow the content marketing route. So, we engage with customers using content. We write custom content, something that's not really available. So pretty much all the financial content in India is again targeted at the top of the pyramid, right? People who understand, who can make sense of some of that. We've targeted our content at the middle, right? Where, and talk to people in their language about problems that are, you know, concern them. So I was talking to some people earlier, some of our most popular content is about bringing up financially grounded children, or having a low-cost wedding. So they're financially related. They are conversations that you would have with a financial advisor, not necessarily related to transactions.
And you are profitable after paying customer acquisition costs, or?
No, so as I said earlier, I think one of the changes to a lifetime value model of a customer, or you know, the advisor model, is that you've got to be ready to capitalize your business until the tail kicks in.
Is your revenue model the trail?
Revenue model is trail.
So you need a certain AUM for you to get the mass?
Correct.
And potentially going forward, does that change? I mean, do you add other revenue streams?
So we could look at other revenue streams. So ultimately, the you know, the idea is to provide the customer. So the way our vision is to curate the right product, really. So it's curation and then making the transaction really smooth. And the key word there is the right product. Right? So, if there is a, so why mutual funds, right? So people tell us why mutual funds. Because mutual funds really make sense. They are today at 1.75% total expense ratio, probably the lowest cost of professional management for active management in the world. Right? And if you're able to get performance like 3% meeting the benchmark, they're a great product. So we will provide similarly other right products to consumers as we go along.
A blunt question. So, there's a certain value you provide, and that's the piece of which you sell, right? And if I find another distributor saying the same thing, and ultimately the action is the same, but they might back a lot of the junk that goes to the client. Would you say that? How would you say you're different from the other guy?
So I think you know, financial brands are not built overnight, and are not built on a transaction basis. I think you've got to be consistently, repeatedly do right by the consumers for you to get that right. So people don't change their advisor overnight. So they won't come to me today, right? Which is why content marketing works for me. It takes time. People check you out. They say you're talking, you're making sense. They come and look at our website. They look at disclosure of commissions. They look at other stuff, and then they will invest.
How do you keep? How do you keep the investors intact? I mean, last year was a bull market, so you got most of the corpus last year, but let's say market is cyclical. So how do you keep them intact? Do you think there is vagaries of the market involving your customer acquisition?
So in fact, if you look at data, if you analyze this data, the total AUM of the mutual fund industry has never declined by more than 5 or 6%. The shifts happen between mutual fund schemes and asset classes, right? So the advisor, the guy panics. The advisor, instead of saying, stay invested in equities, will say, yes sir, sell it, put it into debt, right? Because he makes that upfront commission, right? So he doesn't lose anything. What the customer loses, customer never discovers, right? He's always ready to blame the AMC. So as a result, if you look at the actual, look at the AUM of the total industry AUM, the market's gone down 25%, the AUM has gone down only 8% in that year, right? So we, our belief is AUM doesn't go, AUM stays. But it's the right advice. Our advice to our customers is usually to stay invested.
And who are your competitors in the same space?
So competitors, I think, pretty much everybody and nobody.
right? So seriously, so I think anybody who provides financial products, so banks, they don't actively participate in mutual funds today, but they are potential competitors. Or anywhere people can spend money, right?
Online space.
Online space. Also, online space, there are 3-4 guys. So there is My Universe, ZipZip, there is Funds India, there is MFU, if you consider them, you know, they're the Amfi platform. That's it. But pretty much everybody also has an online platform, right? So I don't think being online is the criteria for competition. When I say nobody is competition, I think it's the approach to consumers, which is an advisory approach, long-term value creation approach. In that, we don't think there is any competition.
How many primary users of fundraise that you, the number?
Expansion. So we're building out, building out IT, spending more on marketing, right? So building out teams. We are a very, very lean team. So before the fundraise, we were 12 people.